Hello guys, and welcome to a new Steel Division video today by me, Vulcan. Today I have for you Eugen versus Chicken Dew in game 1 out of 2 games in the European Steel Division League, Code S. Today we are seeing Bois de la Mort, and on the Allied side, Eugen's taking out the Guards Armoured, and on the Axis side, Chicken Dew has chosen the 17th SS Panzergrenadier. Now, before I move on with the commentary today, I did just want to mention the second European tournament. I had previously casted the first European tournament, also known as Chicken Dew's tournament, and he is looking for people to play in the tournament. So if you're interested in a 1v1 tournament that's going to take place on the 23rd of July or start on the 23rd of July, make sure to check out all of the details in the description. I'll leave two links there. One will be to the sign up, one will be to the tournament details. So if you want any more details about that and are interested in getting involved in the tournament, go check it out. It's open to everyone, not just Europeans. So if you're American or in Asia, then yeah, make sure you check it out as well. Might be something you're interested in. Either way, back to the game. Eugen today, I'm going to be using this Guards Armored. Let's see what he's bringing down on the field. Looks like he is going to be utilizing these Humber Mark IIIs, something that the Guards Armored is very well known for. I, of course, love the Cromwell 7 that the Guards Armored can bring in Phase A. I think it's a very strong unit. However, on Bois de la Mort, it's probably less likely to be seen due to the terrain on this bottom side. You've got all of this forest area, which makes relying on tanks quite unreliable. As you'll probably want to have infantry with close-range fire support, which these Humber Mark IIIs do really well. So that's what we're likely to see. There's also the Stuart 6 there. Again, close-range fire support, has 330 cals, can pin down units quite quickly. So very, very useful for helping your infantry engagements. He's going to be bringing in 3 rifles to that bottom side so far. Let's have a look at what the 17th SS is doing. Now, the 17th SS will be able to put up a very good fight in this sort of forest environment. It does have Nebelwerfers, it does have Stosstroop. And against the Guards Armoured, that's quite a big advantage because they only really have rifles and motorised rifles. There are potential for like assault pioneers, but due to their low strength, they're not particularly difficult to deal with, especially if Chicken Dew does set up a sort of network of Nebelwerfers. The way that Eugen can counter that in Phase B is probably with things like Sextons. And if we see those come in, then Chicken Dew may have some problems. But it also very much depends on Eugen's artillery micro and whether he keeps on top of those Nebelwerfers. Whenever they fire, he has an artillery strike coming right down on them. By the way, on this top side, there is actually going to be a pack 40 at the start accompanied by some command. There's going to be 2 units of Panzergrenadiers, Panzerschreck, Stosstroop, and an IG-18, although it seems as though that's just been replaced. On the bottom side, there's going to be a pack 38, 2 Stosstroop, command infantry, command SBW-223, another Stosstroop, and Panzergrenadiers. So it looks like quite a light amount of infantry, honestly, for this forest area, but I guess it depends where Chicken Dew sort of consolidates his men, because the last thing you really want to do is have rifles go up against Stosstroop 1v1, because at close range rifles have 8 HE, which is actually not too bad to do some damage to Stosstroop at the 100 meter range. Generally, if you're going to use Stosstroop for like anti-infantry purpose, I would say always try and 2v1 your enemy, because you'll cut them down so damn quick that they don't really have a chance to damage your own squads, and that can make Stosstroop really cost efficient. Of course, it does leave you vulnerable to AoE, so area of effect damage that could potentially, like artillery for example, it could potentially hit your squads if you have multiple of them bunched up. But against the Guards Armored, that's less likely to happen due to just the playstyle of division. Now, one thing you may have noticed is that Chicken Dew is bunching up his units here as close as he can to the deployment line here. And that's something I would always recommend people doing. It's something I haven't mentioned in a while. But either way, you want to deploy on roads. You want to try and bunch them up as much as possible so that you get that little bit of time advantage on your enemy, although unless they're doing the same thing, you probably won't get much of an advantage. But at this point, it's all about just maintaining the sort of speed to get to where you want your troops to be. So chicken dew's spreading out quite a lot on this top side. That might be the position for the pack 40, although I'm not entirely sure it's the best place to have it. Let's just have a look. Where's this SDKFZ heading? Okay, it's over here. That's much better because it can get a really nice line of sight down this road and utilize the 1,200 meter range. So it's going to be some Panzergrenadiers taking up this tree line. Some Stosstroop heading to the top side to hold that forwards. Then we have a few infantry squads sort of heading towards the mid, which are going to unload a position down there. There is a Stuart 6 joining the Humber Mark 3 on the top side. That's also going to have some command there and that rifle squad. So Eugen may try and make a little push up here, but in the face of a pack 40, that's going to be pretty hard to do. So when the half track most likely goes first, it will discover that the pack 40 is there, and therefore this push will likely just stop in its tracks as Eugen won't want to just give away points. One interesting thing here, though, is this sort of deployment is really awkward. If the Humber Mark 3 can get line of sight onto some of these transports, might be able to do quite a lot of damage, but it looks like they may have unloaded in time and will be getting into the forest here. You can see that there's two sets of Panzergrenadiers and then one Stosstroop. I can't help but feel that this Panzergrenadier is supposed to be on the bottom side. This SBW 223 in a pretty precarious position at the moment, going to be smoked off by the Stosstroop. But this double Stosstroop on the bottom side is really nice. Like I mentioned, the 2v1 against these rifle squads can be incredibly efficient. So that's something that I expect Chicken Dew to try and utilize throughout this game. Pack 38 has got into position here, might find a shot onto this half track. Doesn't hit with the first shot. Eugen's going to be getting that out the way. No need to unnecessarily lose any units in Steel Division. Ideally, you always want to try and preserve as many units as possible because even if a unit isn't very combat effective, it always holds the front line forwards, unless it's, of course, a recon squad. But recon has a completely different purpose. It provides information. So you never really want to let any units die for free if you can help it. But as you can see, Recce have moved up. Panzergrenadiers get spotted. They're going to come under a hell of a lot of fire. 10 to 5 men in 2 seconds. Came under the fire of the Humber Mark 3 with 16 HE and the Stuart 6 with its 8 HE, and that certainly did a lot of damage. Stoke 3 now coming up, though, to this forest area. Looks like Chicken Dew would like to have something to deal with the Stuart 6 and Humber Mark 3, or at least hold them back for the time being so that he can maybe sort of play around these vehicles elsewhere. So, for example, you have the Stoke 3 here that then allows you to move the Pack 38 into a better flanking position and get shots off. Just stuff like that. Either way, we can see a Nebelwerfer now on the way. There is going to be a Stosstroop coming up behind that. He does need to sort of stop this advance of the rifles into this forest area. Due to Eugen having the cover for his men, he's allowed to sort of move these rifles across the open and into this forest section, which is something that is maybe going to cut off the Stosstroop and therefore push the territory in favor of Eugen. But both players at the moment just kind of vying for territory. M5 half track is going to spot and try and take on this Pack 38, but this could go wrong. Pack 38 takes a shot at the Stuart 6, does not get the hit, and now these units are going to pin down and kill that Pack 38. It had one shot, and unfortunately, for Chicken Dew, it missed. If it had hit the Stuart, that would have been pretty costly for Eugen, since those Pack 38s are only 55 points, whilst his Stuart 6 is 80 points. So it wouldn't have been a favorable engagement. Nebelwerfer now coming down. That's going to try and force back the Humber Mark 3 here, and the Stuart 6 has a chance to kill the M5 half track. Might also kill the motorized rifle leader if it lands on target. Not quite, but does force the fall back, which now allows the Stoke 3 to get aggressive. However, the Stuart 6, it is okay. It's not actually too bad. Like, it did recover quite quickly from that morale. So this Panzergrenadier ends up pinning down the rifles anyway. It looks like Chicken Dew is going to be coming in with a Stosstroop here. Stuke 3 takes out one of the half tracks, but nothing too significant just yet. And these rifles surely gonna end up running into the Stosstroop here and just surrendering, yeah. So that deals with those. Panzergrenadier Panzer Grenadiers did their job in the end. Nebelwerfer, nice strike, but wasn't really capitalised upon by the Stug 3. So now an Opel Blitz Munition has come in, and this is one thing you've got to watch out for when using Nebelwerfers. The Nebelwerfer costs 60 points, and you're probably thinking that's relatively cheap, but when you account for the supply that you have to bring in with it, it's a 110-point artillery piece in Phase A, because you have to reload it every single time it fires. And definitely something to consider when using the 17th SS. Either way, Panzer Grenadiers, they're going to be engaging two units of rifles here at the 100 meter range, and that is not really ideal because they're just going to get pinned and killed off. Easy done there for Eugen. I think the rifles were just over the 100 meter range, which enabled the MG42s to fire, but still the Panzer Grenadiers go down. Chickendew is going to have to supplement that loss in the middle. But an arrival of an IG-18 should definitely help out. An IG-18 in the mid here would be really fantastic, actually, because there isn't really a way for any of this armor to take it out without exposing itself to the PAC-40 by coming round this side of the road. That IG are going to get into position. Then we'll be looking to take on these motorized rifles and rifle units, unless it ends up in front of a Cromwell 7, which is not a place where an IG-18 really wants to be. Yes, the IG-18 will try and fire back, but at the end of the day, Cromwell 6 can, or Cromwell 7 can just shrug that off and do plenty of damage, so the IG's got to get the hell out of there. Another PAC-38 on the way. Nebelwerfer is getting ready to fire once again. Looks like it's seen the 6-pounder here, and we'll be attempting to take that out so that the Stug 3 can safely engage the Stuart 6 and Humber Mark 3 once again. PAC-40, that's going to take shot at that half-track, does reveal its location by doing so, however, which means this Cromwell 7 is unlikely to continue to push forwards, but will be in line of sight here. So Eugen's got to be very careful. He's got to notice that this happening, and he will, and he's got to get out of line of sight. That's exactly what he does. Another half-track is now in line of sight. Eugen just going to be using the trees there to get out of the way. 25-pounder has been brought in already. That's going to be trying to counter the PAC-40 and just pin it so that the armor can start to move forwards in the open up here. Motorized rifles, getting the pin onto the IG is pretty significant, as removing that IG will definitely allow the advance of more infantry without the support of these vehicles. Although, with the PAC-40 being pinned here, that is pretty dangerous, because if the PAC-40 then gets taken out, the Cromwell 7 can move forwards freely, the Stuart 6 can move forwards freely, so can the Humber Mark 3. And Eugen will be aware that the 17th SS Panzer Grenadiers don't have Panzerfausts, and that's something that you can really take advantage of as an armoured division against the 17th in Phase A. So the IG goes down. Rifles are in a position to just continue moving forwards. They might even end up revealing that the PAC-40 is pinned, and that would really be the key for Eugen to then just aggressively push into the PAC-40. Now these poor Panzer Grenadiers, they have been spotted and will be absolutely ripped to shreds, surrounded by Humber Mark 3, the M5 half track, the Stuart 6. Looks like Eugen just trying to clean them up with a surrender there, but they're likely to just die to all of that machine gun fire. Wow. The rifles now getting up into position once again. If the rifles can get into this tree line and reveal the stress on this PAC-40, something that Eugen may take advantage of. Does get a direct hit there as well. Nebelwerfer, though, going to be coming down. That's going to be trying to hold back these motorized rifles. Does affect the front line slightly, but unless it kills off the motorized rifles completely, that kind of was a bit of a wasted Nebelwerfer strike. Cromwell 7 is just quite happy to come around here, although a PAC-38 has been unloaded on the main road, and the PAC-38 on the bottom side is also taking shots. This Cromwell 7 is in trouble. Track wheel destroyed. Really nice ambush here by Chickendew. Gets the critical ammo explosion onto the Cromwell 7. Fantastic job there by Chickendew to stop that push. Eugen saw that the PAC-40 was pinned, fell right into that trap. PAC-38 had been brought in, And this perfect 1,000 meter range there, just onto this road, did the job very nicely indeed. Allows the sort of side shot, because no matter which way that Cromwell 7 faced, it would always be showing side armor. And that was just really, really nice there from Jigindu. 25 pounder though, going to try and make short work of the Pak 38. Artillery micro I mentioned would be very important for Yujin, so making sure he kills off these AT guns is very important. These rifles, they are going to be taking shots at the Pak 40 with their Bren gun, but not the most effective at range due to the 2HE. On the bottom side, I think there was another Nebelwerfer strike that forced the Stuart 6 back and actually ended up with the Cromwell, or not the Cromwell, the Humber Mark 3, sorry, being killed. But now we see a situation where these rifles are engaging Panzergrenadiers at 400 meter range, and the MG42s just have so much more suppression. And then with these rifles half stressed already, the Stoss Troop engaging them is going to be absolutely deadly. Better keep an eye on this top side as well though. So here we go, Stoss Troop getting involved, pins them down almost immediately. And if those do not fall back, they will end up being surrendered or just chewed to pieces by the high HE. Well, this is a pretty important engagement. Motorized rifles finding some Panzerschrecks will allow Yujin to advance with confidence, knowing that's there. Rifles, they are going to retreat and get out of there for now. Nebelwerfer looking for the next strike. Think opening up some movement for the Stoss Troop here might be a good idea, so that's what Chickendew is going for. And bringing in some more Stoss Troop to accompany the Stoss Troop that's already here would be good moving into Phase B. I believe he had already deployed all of his Phase A Stoss Troop in Phase A almost right at the start, so didn't have any more available to make this a 2v1, but still. Stuk 3 in a nice position here, does manage to kill off one of the half tracks. Nebelwerfer comes down on top of the motorized rifle leader and rifles up here. Doesn't have seem to have done too much damage, but Chickendew solidifying this position is really good. Just probably wants to get this Pak 40 back into cover sooner than later, because having it just sat right out in the open there is just waiting for it to get RT'd. But at this moment in time, due to Yujin's aggression on this top side, he is sitting on a plus one with a 56% territory lead. And that's something that he's going to continue to try and exploit. You can see the Sherman 5 now coming in to reinforce. But it really just continues to depend on Chickendew's AT. And at the moment, it seems to be okay. This Pak 38 managed to get out of the way of the 25-pounder shots. This 25-pounder almost out of ammunition as well. So Eugene's going to have to supply that, and he will. It's funny just how these fine margins where there's like two shells left on the 25-pounder and then the supply comes in. It's just really good. It just shows really good game knowledge and like the ability to work on these fine margins. It's a really good player. So Marder 3 has come in to sort of support the mid, but it's in a pretty awkward position with restricted light sight lines. So this is something that like Stuart 6s, for example, can really take advantage of, because if they can get within the sort of 1,000 meter range or even closer, then they have a good chance at defeating a Marder 3 regardless of the size of that gun. Stoss Troop here are going to reveal themselves to the rifles. Rifles just going to back off briefly, allowing the Humber Mark 3 to open up, and that's going to be again 16HE hitting the Stoss Troop in the face, and Stoss Troop really just can't do too much about that, so they are going to get hit pretty hard and even get surrendered, which is going to open up a lot of territory on the top side. And regardless of the Nebelwerfer hitting true here onto a couple of infantry units, it's not going to matter too much. Here comes the Nebelwerfer onto this side as well. Stoss Troop again going to be trying to make some ground. Won't really have any smoke cover, which could be dangerous. But if he can get the Stoss Troop into the other side of the tree line, then he should be okay. But yeah, just the rifle availability of the guards armored might just be enough to hold back any push that Chickendew really wants to make. Make short work of the recon though. That's going to get rid of that. New Panzerschreck comes into the mid. Taking care of this top side is going to be pretty difficult. You can see that Chickendew has now brought in a Stug 4. Fortunately for him, these are not motorized rifles, so the Stug is pretty happy to continue forwards. But I think he's going to need another Stug, probably, to sort of hit from another flank if he really wants to take control of this top side. Because at the moment, Eugen's just sitting in a position where all of his forces are just really, really good at this kind of engagement. Like, Sherman 5 is fantastic at close range. Humber Mark 3, pretty decent at close range. Stuart 6, fantastic at close range. Looks like this Crusader AA took a bit of fire from the Pack 40, but is going to stay alive. Tragwheel destroyed, though, means it's not going anywhere anytime soon. Stosstroop are going to smoke themselves off against these motorized rifles to stop that engagement. These Stosstroop have got pretty far up, which could be quite scary for things like the Sherman 5 and the Humber Mark 3. But I'm not sure that Chicken Dew can see these. Yeah. So he's not going to move towards them if he doesn't know they're there. But if he did, then that's like easily within range of a Panzerfaust, I think, to get the Sherman 5 there. So just having these run forwards and get purposefully cut off so they're behind enemy lines might be a really good idea. Because then Eugen will struggle to find out where they are. The Pack 40 dealt with on the top side, there is not another one in play. Pack 38, though, covering the same position. Stug 4 is going to be looking for the kill onto the Humber Mark 3. It does have plenty of time here to find the kill, but it has no veterancy, so may miss quite a few times. 6 accuracy base is pretty nice. And that's Typhoon AT just hit. Ah, I think it killed the Marder 3. Yeah, nice job there by Eugen to identify that was a possibility. Stug 3 is going to push through in the forest here, takes out the Stuart 6, now looking for the kill onto the Humber Mark 3. Humber Mark 3 is going to try and get the hell out of there. Not sure it's going to have chance though. Or just gets cut off by the line of sight. That is unlucky for Chicken Dew. But now Chicken Dew has Pioneers on his side, and this is a good opportunity for Chicken Dew to make a lot of ground through the forest. I think for Chicken Dew, it's kind of unfortunate he's on the side that he is, because for the 17th SS, generally you want to have more forest to push into, but on this side of things, it's much less than if you were pushing the other way. Now the Nebelwerfer does come in, take out 2 units of infantry, pins down the Assault Pioneers as well. Assault Pioneers trade with normal Pioneers. The Assault Pioneers go down because they're much lower strength. So Pioneers can generally trade 2-for-1 with Assault Pioneers. That's something we've got to look out for. JU-87 did come in on this top side. Not sure if it really killed too much. It looks like it might have taken out the Stuart 6. Didn't look like it had any shots onto the Sherman 5 though. Humber Mark 3 still doing a lot of work onto Panzergrenz though, and Tempest now hanging about. I don't think Eugen really wants the JU-87 to hit again, so just trying to avoid that as much as possible. Assault Pioneers looking for the engagement onto the Panzergrenzführer. Oh, Sherman comes up at close range, weapon jams the Stug 3 right in the face. And now that is a sitting duck, really, for the Sherman 5 to just push forwards and find the kill. Assault Pioneers do their job, taking out the Panzergrenzführer, which is a really nice kill because it takes away the veterancy from these Pioneers, allowing them to be dealt with much easier. Oh, lovely Nibelwerfer strike though on this top side. Is going to pin the Assault Pioneers. Rifles forces back the Humber Mark 3 a little bit. Panzergrenadiers trying to chew up the rifles. 2-2-2 now going to be able to engage the M5 half track. We can see that 3 AA pieces are on the way. These are Flak 36s. And those will assist with future air engagements. But I can't help but feel that Chicken Dew is getting a little light on the ground. And with each of those AA pieces costing 75 points apiece, he may be a little bit short for the time being. We can see that a 2-2-2 did die down here. A Sherman 5 did eventually pick off the Stug 4. Or Stug 3 even. Pioneers, though, they are going to be able to engage and try and take out these rifles. Rifles trying to back off from the grenade that's being thrown there, but will still die to it. On the top side, Panzergrenadiers engaging Assault Pioneers. They got their grenade off, I believe. Panzergrenadiers going to try and retreat. Do get killed. on the 2-2-2 at close range. Got a lot of work to do, but not really going to have much of a chance against the Sherman 5, so needs to be a little bit careful there. AA is revealing itself by firing at the Tempest now. Eugen still maintaining his plus one, regardless of this little salient that's forming on this bottom side. Now, if Chicken Dude can continue to bring in superior infantry to this forest, he can probably get a nice salient down here, which may equal things out. But currently, Eugen's almost at the 1,000 point mark, and that could make all the difference. Artillery there actually ended up pinning down Eugen's own infantry, which isn't ideal, because now they're not really going to be able to utilize that very well. Or can the Tempest still get the kill? It does. It is going to trade for the Focke-Wulf 190, though. Interesting engagement. Yeah, Eugen came in, shot down the Ju-87, which definitely matters more than a Focke-Wulf. Focke-Wulf returns the kill. Sherman 5 now coming around on that top side. I mentioned that the 2-3-2 would not really be able to do too much. And here you can see that happening. 2-3-2 is being forced to fall back. Sherman 5 taking its sweet time to get the kill, though. Neville there for firing off once again. I think these sort of Nebelwerfer strikes, they've been put in like the right locations, but just haven't really been capitalized upon very well, because the 17th SS is actually quite a slow division, and it's something that we've seen be a problem here against the sort of motorized units that the Guards Armored really take advantage of. Rifles though engaging the Panzergrenadier at close range. If those go down, it takes away the veterancy from the Pioneers. If the Pioneers now die, and that will leave a gaping hole in Chicken Dew's defense on his bottom side. Sostroop looking for the engagement with the motorized rifles there, but the motorized rifles told to back off from that by Eugen. And these motorized rifles finding the Panzergrenadiers. Flak 36s now coming under artillery fire. I don't think Chicken Dew can really afford to lose these Flak 36s because he invested so many points into them. Stug 4 now coming in though to try and solidify the mid. But the Stuart 6 and Hummer Mark 3s are just so good at this sort of range engagement. And even with a Pack 38 coming in to ambush on the tree line, I feel like this is just going to be dead. Yeah, way too quickly. Does manage to transmission damage the Stuart 6, which will be annoying for Eugen, but not too bad. At least it's still alive. And in the forest here, rifles take a grenade for the Assault Pioneers. Assault Pioneers then come in and take out Chicken Dew's Assault Pioneers. 2-2-3 goes down. These Stosstroop have been surrounded already, so they're not affecting the front line. Panzerstreck is just sitting in the way, and that's going to be now 62% territory for Eugen. Huge collapse of Chicken Dew's forces on this bottom side. Needs to reinforce those as soon as possible. Otherwise, he's just going to be waiting to lose the rest of the game. And currently, at the moment, with the amount of forces that Eugen really has on the field at the moment compared to Chicken Dew, it's really not looking good. Typhoon AT coming in towards the top side, then going to turn in, try and get the side shot here, or even the rear shot into the Stug 3, or Stug 4, sorry. Does manage to hit it quite hard, forcing it to fall back, but don't think there's going to be a kill there. The Stug 3 will just back off for now. Tempest is going to be forced to fall back, so is the Focke-Wulf, so no worries there for Eugen this time around. Stuart 6 is looking for the kill onto the 2-2-2. Artillery is now trying to finish off that Flak 36. So yeah, best bet here is just to get more Pioneers in if Chicken Dew has them. He might be low on infantry availability at this point, though. That is a very big possibility. Yeah, he needs to get more Pioneers in here. Just use those to solidify these positions. The trouble is, with Pioneers, is that they can't really smoke themselves off, and Chicken Dew doesn't have any smoke to like cover off against these vehicles. So a Sherman 5 is going to make it really difficult, for example, to push across the open, say from here to here, or from here to here, if it's placed in the right location. And that can be incredibly annoying to deal with when you don't have smoke at your disposal. Flak 36 going to be trying to force back some units in the mid here. We can see that one of them has already died. This one going to be opening up onto infantry as well. Unfortunately, with these sort of units revealing themselves, it does just leave them open to artillery. Sexton now on the field accompanying the 25-pounder. I think investing in this 25-pounder really early on was a fantastic idea by Eugen. Really allowed him to clean up a lot of the Pak-38s and Pak-40s that Chickadee was trying to use. Pak-38 does go down, the Flak-36 will soon follow. Look forward to trying to get into a position where it can hold the line. But these close-range engagements are just always risky for Chickadee, and although he's holding on for the time being, it's not looking like there's going to be much of a comeback anytime soon. Saying that, Panzerdreck getting a kill onto the Sherman 5 is nice. Might open up the possibility for some decent engagements in the forest. I mentioned how these units would be really good at covering the advance of other units, or like the enemy units, and well, in this case, Panzerdreck going down, Pioneers being pinned, is not fantastic, and these Recce not even dying, so these Pioneers going to continue to take that fire. Humber Mark 3 does get forced to fall back. Stug Ford actually went down in the mid. That was the Firefly on this top side. Firefly then gets hit by the JU-87. Tempest is going to come in for the kill, try and trade that, will do so. Bockwolf 190 going to be forced to fall back, but that Firefly certainly did its job taking out the Stug. Very, very nice kill there. Now this Stug trying to get some damage done onto the Humber Mark 3, but that's just going to be moved out of the way. And Eugen's placement of units throughout this game has just been absolutely perfect. It really has. Just utilizing the sight lines to really make it difficult for Chickadee to advance, because all of his tanks are self-propelled guns. And with that being the case, he's never going to win an engagement where he drives around the edge of a tree line. Not against something like a Stuart 6 or a Sherman, which has superior aim time anyway. So although Chickadee has the Stosstroop on the bottom side, they're not being too effective at the moment. These Stosstroop are going to have to smoke themselves off and get into cover. Well, the half-track might be looking there to hunt them down. And that may force the Stosstroop to use up their second smoke grenade, and if they don't, they're just going to get chewed up. And that's exactly what's happened. Stosstroop go down. So does the Stug 4. Well, I think that Stug 4 just took a side shot from the Stuart 6 there. Came around at close range, found that engagement. Unfortunately, I've missed the death of a lot of these Stugs throughout the game, but I've mentioned that it may be the case that they die due to these close range engagements, and due to Eugen's micro across the entire map throughout this game, it's been hard to keep track of. Sexton does end up taking out another Flak 36, and all of Chickadee's AA is now gone. He is now relying on Pak 43s, and I think it's more just a matter of sort of killing as much as he can just to get retribution rather than actually winning the game. Smart use of the Nebelwerfer here, though, by Chickadee, picking up the Opal, or picking up the Nebelwerfer with the Opal Blitz and just moving it back, changing its location. Then you do like an unload at position command, and then when it unloads, it will start reloading again. Panzerstreck does get taken out in the mid. Unfortunate for Chickadee, would have liked to use that Panzerstreck to kill off maybe the Sherman 5 or something, but it is in a pretty obvious place when you put it in buildings. The best place for Panzerstrecks, in my opinion, are like things like orchards, or just like these random tree lines, or these like random sort of heavy cover, like dotted about, because those aren't the places that infantry often checks, because it requires them to run across the open. But Eugen really in a commanding position here, does sit on a plus 3 right now, 3 minutes until victory. Pak 43 already under fire from a artillery, and that's going to make it completely ineffective against anything that it can see, if it can see anything at all, and it can't, because Eugen's use of sightlines throughout this game has just been spot on. He's really, really taken advantage of the trees and all of the hedgerows and tree lines on Bois de la Mort, and it's been really, really nice to watch. Showing that an armored division can really take control on a map against an infantry division that should suit the infantry division, or it should be in the infantry division's favour. I mean, that's not necessarily the case with the 17th SS, because like I mentioned, a lot of their tanks and fire support is self-propelled, which makes things very difficult. A lot of their AT guns are obviously very static, so artillery is a hard counter. But at the same time, the way that Eugen's worked his way through the forest down here has been really smart, and he's basically had a lot of good unit preservation, which means that he has a ton of half-tracks now. Makes things very difficult for infantry to engage his infantry without coming under fire by at least one unit. So it's just really smart play. Or Pack 40 there, bouncing off the front of the Sherman 5, is pretty unlucky. Pack 43 was almost going to take a shot, but Sherman 5 backs off once again. Line of sight coming into play there. Sherman 5 now moving down on this side. It's just, yeah, these vehicles work so well in this environment. And you can really see it coming to full fruition here. Not really much these AT guns can do. Maybe you can find a one shot here and there. But that's really what you can do, is relying on, and when luck is not on your side, that's not going to happen. And these Nebelwerfer strikes, they've been trying, but just haven't really been hitting the mark. Typhoon AT does do a lot of damage there to the Pack 43. Bockwolf probably going to get on the back of the Typhoon and shoot it down, so little consolation prize there for Chicken G, but doesn't want to get over the AA of Eugen, otherwise he's going to find that his Focke-Wulf goes down as well. As Tempest, low on and fuel, is going to be told to evac. Here comes the artillery once again. It's just absolutely constant. I don't think these artillery pieces have really stopped firing for like the entire game, and that's a really, really good way to use your artillery, and something that Eugen has shown us a masterclass in, really, throughout this game. He's only got two artillery pieces. He made it look like he had way more, honestly. But after 32 minutes and 12 seconds, the victory points are going to be reached, and Eugen is victorious with 2,655 kills to 2,655, or 1,685 losses. Okay. Fantastic job by Eugen. Commiserations to Chicken G losing the first game, but he does have a second game to come back at Eugen and see if he can do a better job. I don't think there was really too much that Chicken G did wrong. Maybe sort of allowing Eugen to get the ground on the top side early was not necessarily a great thing. I think the Stug coming into the forest was okay, but might have been better used on the top side. Because if you sort of use that 1,000 meter range engagement in the early game against the Guards Armored, especially with 14 AP, there's not really much on the side of the Guards Armored that can match that. So you can take out the Humbers, you can take out the Stuart 6s, all the half tracks and stuff, and the Stug 3 is really, really good at that. So utilizing it on that very top side so that Eugen couldn't get into those awkward positions would have been quite nice. Pack 40 didn't really pay itself off either. It was in a nice position, but just wasn't really, like, Eugen didn't fall into the trap. He just played it very standard, used recon very well to spot these units and then artillery them, and bringing in the 25 pounder early on sort of removed a lot of the use of Chicken G's AT guns, because as soon as he reveals an AT gun, it's just going to come under artillery fire, and then the really, really fast units of the Guards Armor could then take advantage of that. So throughout the game, Chicken G's defense was always very precarious, and that's something that Eugen really took advantage of. Sherman 5s, they did well, taking out a Stug 4 there. This Sherman 5 took out the Stug 3. 25-pounder killing the Pack 38, both of the Flak 36s. Didn't necessarily pick up the kills onto all of the pack guns, but it was still very important for them to be pinned down so that other units could then move in and kill them. Firefly took out the Stug before it got killed by the Ju-87. Sherman 5 again killing another Stug 4. Again, these are all mainly down to close range engagements. In terms of losses, Stug 3 held back the armor in the forest eventually, but it took a while to find those kills. Unfortunately, the Nebelwerfer, the hit initially didn't quite hit the mark onto the Stuart 6, so the Stuart 6 didn't get forced to fall back into the line of sight of the Stug 3, and that made quite a difference in that forest engagement. Some of the engagements between assault pioneers and pioneers as well wasn't ideal, but this is what you should see, like a pioneer trading for two assault pioneers. That's pretty much what you want to see, because then you'll have more infantry availability that allows you to then take advantage of that with the remaining pioneers that you have. But infantry availability was something that I feel that Chickendee was suffering with in the forest towards the late game, or maybe just didn't have the points from losing stuff elsewhere to reinforce that effectively. So yeah, Eugen just really, really playing this one well. Not too many mistakes from Chickendee, but Eugen just taking full advantage. Hopefully you guys enjoyed it. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Goodbye.